Well, welcome everyone to this inaugural event of our forum this year. It's a delight to see you all. Thank you for coming, and I just want to thank our distinguished group of panelists for being with us tonight. You know, we established this practice of a forum each year in 2005 as a vehicle to bring leading authorities in important issues to campus to stimulate a conversation and reflection on issues that affect us all, that can be dealt with in a multidisciplinary way, that can stimulate our thinking about the important issues of this day. And this year, an election year, our forum topic is A More Perfect Union, the Future of America's Democracy. Big subject, and in the course of this year, we'll have other events to help us reflect on that topic. But tonight, we're tremendously pleased to welcome a group of experts to engage in a topic entitled Conviction and Compromise, Being a Person of Faith in a Liberal Democracy. I think it's indisputable that in the history of the United States, from its founding to today, religious faith has been an extremely important factor and help to make this nation vibrant and strong and creative. There have also been challenges and reflections, difficulties about what role faith has to play in the public forum. Our panelists tonight will help us reflect on the role of faith, the role of religion in political life in our nation. And we've invited two notable, distinguished Notre Dame faculty members to help guide this discussion. I'd like to introduce Professor David Campbell, a professor of political science and the founding director of the Rooney Center for the Study of American Democracy, and Cathy Kaveny, the John P. Murphy Foundation Professor of Law and a professor of theology. Again, thank you for coming. We welcome you all to this forum and to a year-long discussion of important topics about our political life in this country. And now, with a great deal of pleasure and pride, I will turn things over to Professors Campbell and Kaveny. Thank you very much. Great.
Well, thank you very much, Father Jenkins, and thank you to our audience for being here tonight for what we hope will be a stimulating discussion. Just before we get to the introductions of our panelists, I should note that it's a good time to be at Notre Dame. The semester has begun, so no one has had an exam yet, the sun is shining, and the Fighting Irish are undefeated.
Yeah, that's right.
This is truly a historic event. It's a historic event because tonight we will model what it means for Notre Dame to be a Catholic university in a capital C sense, while also being a Catholic university in the lowercase c sense, where we've brought together leaders of many of America's major religious traditions. Indeed, when you think about who we've assembled on the stage here, it's almost like the beginning of a joke. We have a rabbi, we have an archbishop. Each of our panelists has done a lot in their lives. We could not hope to list all of their many accomplishments. So we'll just give you a brief introduction of who these folks are and the positions that they hold. And through the course of the evening, I'm sure you'll hear more about their background and the experience and insight that they bring to the questions before us today. So let us begin with Reverend Richard Cizik, who is the president of the New Evangelical Partnership for the Common Good, sitting next to me.
All right, and next up is Most Reverend Joseph Kurtz, Archbishop of Louisville, and Vice President of the United States Conference of Catholic Bishops.
Seated next to him is Elder Dallin H. Oaks, a member of the Quorum of the 12 Apostles of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints.
And moving along in the line, we have Rabbi David Saperstein, who is the director and counsel of the Religious Action Center of Reform Judaism.
And finally, we have Pastor Rick Warren, the senior pastor and founder of the Saddleback Church and author of The Purpose-Driven Life, a book with sales that makes all of us who have ever written a book extremely jealous. Professor Kaveny.
Okay, well, the way we've structured our questions this evening is to offer some specific questions to each of our panelists that try to open up some of their traditions' views on the relationship of faith and politics and public life. And so I'm going to begin with a question, and then Professor Campbell is going to do the next question. We'll go back and forth. But I'd like to ask each of the panelists in this series, before you answer your particular question, to just give us a little bit of help in understanding what your faith tradition is and your role within that tradition, and also some sense of whether that role offers or includes offering political guidance to members of your faith. And anything else that you think our audience of Notre Dame and South Bend citizens and voters needs to know about your tradition, please feel free to ask. And so the first question is for Elder Oaks. This period has been described as the Mormon moment, when many Americans are learning about the LDS faith for the first time. What should your fellow Americans know about LDS teachings regarding political involvement?
Thank you. At your invitation, I'll say a word first about the church and my place in it. The Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints is neither Catholic nor Protestant. We are a restored church, affirming that the fullness of Christian doctrine and the power of the priesthood needed to be restored after being lost in the centuries following Christ. And our church is led by three men, a president and two counselors, who are apostles. And the second group in seniority is the Quorum of 12 apostles, and I am a member of that group. And our function is to assist the first presidency, our three leaders, in supervising the spiritual activities of the church and also to teach its principles. Our church tries to stay away from political activity in all of the more than 150 nations where we have members. We therefore offer no political guidance to members of our faith, and we rarely take a position on public policies. In the United States, our membership includes Democrats like Senator Harry Reid, Republicans like Governor Mitt Romney, and many independents. As citizens, our church members are encouraged to participate in political and governmental affairs, including involvement in the political parties of their choice. Our church is neutral, however, on political parties, platforms, and candidates. We don't endorse any party or candidate, and we don't advise our members how to vote. However, in very exceptional situations reserved for the decision of the presidency of the church, we would take a position on a public issue that we consider to have very important moral implications. Events in the last few decades have led us to conclude that we must unite with persons of all faith to teach and exercise the principle of religious freedom so that we are assuring our ability to unite on the things we have in common and assuring our ability to act out and exercise those things that we do not have in common.
Thank you. David?
The next question is for Archbishop Kurtz. So again, please take a moment, describe your faith, your role within it. I suspect there might be some in the audience who are at least somewhat familiar with your faith, but just in case. And in addition, Here's something I think that's on the mind of many people on the campus today. Many devout Catholics are torn when deciding how to vote because no single party fully reflects Catholic teachings. There is the document, Faithful Citizenship, which provides guidance on this question, but my query for you is, what advice would you personally give Catholic voters who might be conflicted as they approach the presidential election?
Good, thanks, David. And first of all, it's great to be here at the University of Notre Dame. It's nice also to participate in a winning season. Many of you know this. If you first consider the Catholic Church, you might consider what we visibly look like, and people would observe that there's about 1.1 billion people in the world who are united in a belief in our sacramental life and worship and in our moral convictions. We are gathered under the leadership of the Vicar of Christ on Earth, Pope Benedict, and the bishops of each diocese are seen as successors of the apostles. And so there's a visible presence within our church of a unity and a leadership. There's also, though, what we might call the invisible part of the church, and in some ways that's the most exciting part, and that is has often been called the mystical body of Christ, where we not only are followers of Jesus Christ, humbly are formed in the person of Christ to whom we owe our salvation and seek constantly to live out that salvation, but in a sense we're called to share Christ with others so that we might say in one way, for the average Catholic, your faith is very personal, but that doesn't mean that it's private. It is personal, but also public. So it's not possible for us very well to say, well, I'm going to confine the gift of faith to a very narrow 1 hour or 1 hour and 15 minutes on Sunday or Saturday night, but rather, it's a 24/7 life. We are formed in the faith, and tonight especially, it's important because it's really a moral obligation for us to be involved in the society in which we live, to seek, to participate in articulating the common good, and that's not an easy task, and to bring, in a sense, a moral character to a just public order. So that's a little bit. Now, I'll say something else. I'm from Louisville, Kentucky, and some of you may know we have a little horse race there once a year. And it's in Louisville that we gather as 24 counties, the Catholics, to form the Archdiocese of Louisville. And so, as an archbishop, I have a special honor and responsibility not only to participate in the leadership and governance of the Universal Church, but also to help and serve in a leadership capacity within the Archdiocese of Louisville, that section of central Kentucky. It was also mentioned, David, I think, said, or maybe Kathleen, that I'm the vice president of the United States Conference of Catholic Bishops. And sometimes people mistakenly think, well, maybe that's part of a governing structure. With very few exceptions, the Conference of Bishops is really a service organization. We serve the individual bishops in assisting them in pastoral care, and as was alluded to by Elder Oaks, we also, on important public issues, we take stances and seek to educate people, and in a good democracy, to persuade people in a rational and in a very passionate way. Now, to answer, David, the question, you probably thought I forgot that. Sometimes people think, well, they said, well, we know you have faithful citizenship, but what do you really think? And really, I think faithful citizenship. Now, here's what I mean. The work that we're about is lifelong formation. And when I say we, I mean all of us in this room. The definition of a conscience that I like the best is a conscience, is the voice of God resounding in the human heart. Now, if you believe that, and I do, then conscience is not simply a matter of, well, what do I feel like doing? Or conscience is not simply a question of, what do I want to do? Or even, I guess at the worst, how is this going to benefit me? Conscience is the lifelong process of uncovering God's plan. One of the reasons faithful citizenship is issued usually a year to a year and a half before an election is precisely because while the election is a focus, especially a national election, the process of formation is lifelong. I'll give you a little bit of an analogy. We have a beautiful Trappist monastery at Gethsemane in Kentucky, and Abbot Elias, who is the abbot there, he says, you know, there's a lot of interest in contemplative prayer these days. People love to learn about contemplative prayer. He says, there's just one problem. They want to do it in 2.5 to 3 hours. And basically, prayer is a lifelong process. It's a relationship with God. So that's the first thing that I would say in answering the question. I think the second thing I would say is when you study, and indeed, if you're going to form your conscience, you can't do that without being a student. So when you study the moral implications of various issues, the book, the document Faithful Citizenship, it's about 35 pages, and that includes the pictures. The first 17 is really the meat, and that includes the pictures. So I'm trying to sell. I don't get a profit, by the way, if you buy that. But Faithful Citizenship does show us that certain moral issues have more weight than others. So the Catholic Church will say in our beliefs that the taking of innocent life will always be an issue that is morally wrong. And so we'll, quite frankly, in that document say that we use the term intrinsically evil. So informing your conscience, the document and the bishops, there's two things we don't do. We don't endorse candidates, and we don't coerce voters. They're the two things that we don't do. What we do is invite you to form your conscience, which is probably the most important exercise that you will do in your whole lifetime. In the end, we are in a democracy, David, in which I think we are at our best when we seek to persuade with rational arguments, but also with, I hope, a passion. So rational arguments, but also a passion. And I will also join with Elder Oaks in saying that religious freedom, our first freedom, is something that maybe we will learn through this exercise throughout the United States to really cherish what is not only important in our own lives, but really in the fabric of how a nation deepens its moral character. So I thank you for that.
Thank you. Okay, well, we're moving from one religious tradition to a different religious tradition, and we're going to ask this question to the rabbi. Could you please let us know a little bit about how, from the Jewish perspective, the proper relationship between church and state, maybe not church, but religious institution and state, should be understood, and maybe give us also some sense of how you think that the broader American population can learn from the Jewish experience in the United States and what that would be.
We'll have a chance to explore this later. I actually think most of us approach how we apply our religious traditions to politics in very similar ways, and I hope we have a chance to pursue that. I represent the National Reform Jewish Movement. There are in the world about 15 million Jews, 6 million in Israel, 6 million in the United States. In the United States, there are three major streams of the Jewish community, the Reform, Conservative, and Orthodox. There are other streams as well. There are basically two types of Jews. Those, I'll call them traditional, who believe in the Bible being the written word of God and subsequent laws also having come directly from God as recorded in the Talmud. And those who believe that these were written by men and women striving to understand what God calls us to do, a process that has continued throughout the generations. I'm of that liberal theological strand. In the United States, the Reform Jewish movement is by a little bit the larger segment of American Jewry. And all of the Jewish community has had at the center of its self-identification this passion for tikkun olam, for the perfection of the world, for social justice. How, after all, can we really be alike to the nations, as we are called to be, fulfilling the charge to bring a prophetic witness and preach truth to power, if we don't speak out on the great moral issues of the lives of our members, the lives of our fellow citizens, and the public policy positions that mark the moral quality and character of any society. And so we have a long tradition of speaking out. Now understand, Jewish law is a contract between, in traditional Jewish thought, between God and the Jewish people. Jewish law is not binding upon non-Jews or non-Jewish societies. But we do have certain core ideas that our tradition says are universal and applicable to all people for all time. And it's similar to the natural law approach of the Catholic Church and that much of the Christian world has accepts. That is the fundamental dignity of every human being based on the notion we're creating the image of God. That's a foundation for our belief in religious freedom. The basic equality from the interpretations of the Bible that ask, why are we all descended from one couple, Adam and Eve, so none can claim that the merit of our ancestors was greater than anyone else's. Third, the belief in the perfectibility of individual human beings in the world. Not that we can be perfect. We're always capable of doing better. Fourth, the belief that what we own in a trust relationship with God. And the terms of that trust involve protecting the corpus of the trust, environmental laws that go back to the Bible, but also the mandate, the requirement to share God's wealth with those of God's children who are more needy. And the pursuit of peace, the pursuit of justice, and above all, freedom of choice. I have set before you this day a life and death, a blessing and a curse, good and evil. And God doesn't say, now I will tell you which you must choose. But almost as though God is pleading with humanity, saying, I've given to you that which I've given to nothing else in creation, the ability to understand the difference between right and wrong, and to choose between right and wrong, good and evil, the blessing and the curse. And I can tell you what you should do and why, but ultimately, if my word is to live on earth, it will be because of the choices that you make. Therefore, choose life that you and your children after you might live. So God has not ordained for non-Jewish societies monarchies or democracies, socialism or capitalism, democracy or monarchies or supply-side economics or food stamp programs. These are human inventions. And good moral people have to test them. Do they further or impede those universal values that are applicable to all people and all societies? And good moral people can differ over that, but you can't ignore the requirement to test those policies and pursue policies that you think best achieve those. In the United States, therefore, obviously, in the Bible, there was no separation of church and state, right? But in the United States, we Jews have known more rights, more freedoms, more opportunities than we've known anywhere else in our diaspora life, in millennia. And why? Because of the three provisions in the Constitution: no religious test for office, no establishment of religion, and free exercise of religion. Here, for the first time in human history, we said the rights that you had as an individual are not dependent upon your religious beliefs, your religious practices, your religious identity. What an extraordinary thing for us. And America has given us more opportunities and freedoms than we know everywhere else. Most of us in the Jewish community cherish separation of church and state here in America. We do it because we think it's good for religion. There are differences in this panel. And I don't care if people want to argue the policy. No here would say what I'm about to say, but we often get accused, those of us who believe in separation of church and state, for it being anti-God and anti-religion. Nothing could be further from the truth. It is that wall that's kept government out of religion, that's allowed religion to flourish with diversity and strength in America, unmatched anywhere in the democratic world. Far more freedoms, far more opportunities, far more people believing in God, far more people going to worship regularly than in any other democracy. What an extraordinary country. So in terms of church and state within the Jewish tradition, obviously they were merged. In terms of what we think is best for religion in a non-Jewish state like America, here we think that the separation of church and state has served religion and served America in deep and profound ways, and we ought to be cautious in abandoning that great heritage that we've been given.
Thank you.
Thank you. Well, we will turn now to Reverend Cizik. We're going to talk a little bit about evangelical Christians who have become, over the last 30 or so years, an important political force in America. And I really want to ask two questions. First, on balance, what has been the effect of this political involvement on evangelical Protestantism as a tradition? So what has been the effect of that political involvement on evangelicals? And what has the effect of that evangelical involvement been on the country as a whole? And then maybe we could take just a second and hear your thoughts on looking forward. Where do you see evangelicalism headed? Are there new issues that you think might be coming on the agenda?
New issues? That's right in line. I have to make a plug, a new evangelical manifesto. Here you have it, the Chalice Press. Thank you very much, David. Forgive me all.
Do we have copies for sale?
No, I'm sorry to say. I was at the Rio Summit on the Environment. From there, I went to the London Summit on Family Planning, and from there, Aspen for the Americans for Renewable Energy, and I was heading to Kampala to protest the Kill the Gays bill when an Ebola outbreak broke out. And so I spent my summer on issues I care about. Let me talk about a little bit about evangelicals, as you've asked. By the way, the answer to your question is, has it been positive influence, that of evangelicals, upon the country on balance? Because you put the words on balance in. And after all, I spent 28 years with the National Association of Evangelicals, 10 of those years as the head of the Governmental Affairs Office. I couldn't hardly say it hasn't been. After all, why would you stay if it hasn't been? So I say on balance, yes. But I say that because I'm torn. And I'll tell you why in just a second. First of all, a quick story. An evangelical is riding in his Jeep Cherokee, slams on his brake, he walks over to the shepherd and he says, if I can tell you how many sheep you have, can I have one? And the shepherd, who's totally dumbstruck, he says, well, I don't know, I guess so. And the American goes back into his Jeep, he gets onto GPS, that's God's positioning satellite, and within a matter of moments, he has a ream of paper like I have, comes back and he says, you have 1,638 sheep. Oh my gosh, the shepherd's totally dumbstruck. He says, that's amazing, how did you know? Go pick one out. Well, the American does. He's leaving in his Jeep when the shepherd runs up, knocks on the window, and he says, sir, he says, if I can tell you what you do for a living, can I have my sheep back? And the American says, no way is he going to guess that. The shepherd says, you are a consultant. And the American's totally dumbstruck. He says, well, how did you know? And the shepherd says, well, first of all, you come into my world about which you know nothing. You answer questions I've never asked even myself. You can leave out, charge me a lot of money. And lastly, he says, you don't know diddly squat. You took my sheepdog. So in every one of those instances, whether it's in Rio, where the perception is by even the local that evangelicals talking about climate change, no way, or Americans for renewable energy, evangelicals on this subject of mercury and other carbon dioxide pollution, no, evangelicals don't do that, or going to Kampala or to London on family planning, why family planning equals abortion, and we know about evangelical homophobia. So an evangelical going to Kampala to protest the Kill the Gays bill, what's that about? Well, why am I conflicted? I can look at all the admirable things, many of these things I've worked with people on this panel on for years, particularly David, because he's a Washingtonian. whether it be the AIDS issue, which Rick and his wife, Kay, are so well known for, or whether it's the International Religious Freedom Act that goes back to the 1980s, or RFRA, which we know Elder Oaks has even been involved in, or the Catholics engaged on the issues of the culture of life. All these issues, evangelicals have, of course, been engaged admirably, and sometimes even effectively. But I'm torn because I know that our witness has been marred by the fact that we do not have, and as a movement, we don't have a common good philosophy. We don't have that. We have an ironclad allegiance to one political party. Can you guess which one that is? You don't need to even think further than last week's convention to know which party that is. And we also, you see, have not been thinking about the culture wars and what they have wreaked on our society. And so I'm torn because, additionally, my personal narrative is that after 28 years of giving my life, blood, sweat, and tears, to a ministry, I gave an interview to Terry Gross. Her program is called Fresh Air. And I guess I gave too much fresh air because I was asked to tender my resignation about a week later. And the reason why was because I said, her first question was, Richard, who do you vote for? And I said, could you please just turn off the mics? Let me think about how to answer that one. And I decided to answer it. I thought I would sort of split the difference. I said, well, I voted for Obama in the Virginia primary, as if to think people wouldn't think, well, he really did vote for Obama in the general election. I said that I could support civil unions just like 40% of all evangelicals nowadays and a significant percentage of younger evangelicals. I said I supported the science of climate change and, well, you get the drift. The religious right had a conniption fit and I resigned. It was deeply hurtful. I've recovered. They asked me to sign a non-disparagement agreement, which I said I didn't need to do because I wasn't going to criticize the evangelical movement, least of all the people who I'd worked for and with for 28 years. But they didn't ask me to sign a non-compete agreement. So within about a few hours, 100 evangelical leaders had agreed to these things. They had agreed to see and think more clearly. Yeah, to think. You know, most Christians, H.L. Mencken said, would rather die than think, and they do. To care more deeply, to really care about this country and where it's going. And caring means assuming responsibility for our actions in dividing this country and the polarization which we have contributed to. And by the way, when the next event occurs in Washington, the Family Research Council event, you'll hear a lot of victimhood, the war on Christians, and it's a base appeal to resentment that results in polarization and contributes to the divide we have today. And so I say we've really got to care more deeply and to act more boldly in behalf of civility, and that's why I'm here tonight.
Thank you. Okay, thank you. Well, I think that that's a wonderful lead-in to the question we have for Pastor Warren, which is about civility. How do we, in America, people of faith, balance our concern to speak the truth, to speak the truth to power, sometimes to speak uncomfortable truths, with the need to respect one another as made in the image and likeness of God and as citizens? Yeah. Can you tell us something after you kind of give us your sense of the evangelical world, which is every bit as complicated as the Catholic world and the Jewish world, it seems, some sense of what you might have learned from hosting at Saddleback a conversation between presidential candidates John McCain and Barack Obama, which was focused really on civility.
Yeah, it was. Well, first, thank you everybody for coming. This really says more about you than it does us here on stage. I love these guys. Most of them I've known for a long time. We have serious differences, but one of the things we want to model is you can disagree without being disagreeable. You can walk arm in arm without seeing eye to eye on everything. And the truth is today, our civilization is losing its civility. And we are not, and the internet is increasing this personal attacks. And it's very easy to be blatantly rude behind the safety of a screen. Anybody's ever read a blog knows that can be true. So thank you guys for showing up for this. It matters to you. I'd like to thank Father Jenkins for planning it. And I would thank you, Kathy and David, for hosting it. I think this is a key issue, the issue of civility in our civilization. I am an evangelical. I am a Baptist. But as a pastor, I believe in both the good news and the common good. And we live in America, which is a pluralistic democracy, which nobody wins all the time. Sometimes I win, sometimes somebody else wins. Nobody wins all the time. And you have to learn to get along, as that great theologian Rodney King said. can we all just get along? I'll give you my bias. Number one in my mind is Jesus said, my kingdom is not of this world. So I began looking at politics first with the frank limitation of politics. No matter who gets elected, the maximum influence they're going to have is about 8 years, maybe 4 years as a presidency. The church has been around for 2,000 years, okay? Moses has been around thousands and thousands of years. And so ultimately, where we're going, I don't place all of my faith in government to change. If I thought you could change the human heart through politics, I'd be a politician. Now, politics has its place, but no law is going to turn a bigot into a lover. That's a spiritual transformation. You can change behavior, but you can't change their attitudes. So I think there are a number of things. First, people often ask me, are you right wing, are you left wing? And I say, I'm for the whole bird. I'm not right wing, and nobody gets it right all the time. I have friends who are Republicans, I have friends who are Democrats, I'm for my friends. I don't agree with any of them all of the time. I'm probably the only person in history who actually did the inaugural prayer at a Republican's inauguration and at a Democrat's inauguration, because my role is not partisan, my role is pastoral. So I've known every president since Carter, and I've never given one single policy advice. Not one. That's not my role. My role is, how's your family? Are you maintaining your integrity? How's your walk with God? You know, the personal issue. So there's a pastoral issue there. Actually, I'm registered independent, and I do that intentionally so that I can minister to both sides. I pastor in Orange County, California, which is a very conservative county. But with all of the immigrants moved in, my church now speaks 67 languages. Saddleback speaks 67 languages. And so I have to shepherd everybody of all different sizes, shapes, and political persuasions. And I believe in the separation of church and state. I do not believe in the separation of faith and politics. There's a big difference. By the way, separation of church and state was instilled to protect the church from the state. David just mentioned that. That was the reason it was installed. There are two famous letters by Thomas Jefferson, one to the Danbury Baptist and the other to the African Methodist Episcopals on separation church state. I actually own the second document. If I were to sell it today, it'd be worth about $1 million if any of you'd like to buy it. It's handwritten by Jefferson, in which he says the government has no role in determining the conscience of its citizens, has no role in determining what a church should believe or act. My concern today in politics is that we're moving away from freedom of religion to freedom of worship. And I've actually heard this term being bandied around by State Department and others saying, reclassify freedom of worship. Freedom of worship means then you're free to do whatever you want to do during that hour of the Mass. But my faith involves far more than just the service. The Bible says Jesus went into every village preaching, teaching, and healing. So Jesus was a preacher, he was a teacher, and he was a healer. So there was evangelism, there was education, and there was health care. One third of Jesus' ministry was health care. He was healing, okay? And so that's why you go into most countries, the first hospital and the first school in almost every country were started by Christian missionaries. So to say that my faith, I only have freedom in my worship part and not in my other parts is very restraining to me. But I believe in education, not promotion. I think everybody said this here. Nobody publicly endorses a candidate. I've never done that. I never would. But I do believe that, as I said, I held forums. We do civil forums just like this at Saddleback a couple times a year. I told David the very first one we did was on the Holocaust. And I had six Jewish Holocaust survivors come and just share their stories. So we'd say, never again. We've done genocide, we've done trafficking, we've done reconciliation, we've done globalization. I've had sitting presidents, I've had prime ministers, presidents of other countries. And so my role is primarily education, getting people to understand that faithful citizenship is a real deal. Okay, it's a real deal. It's a legitimate deal. And the fact is, every faith, whether it's Judaism or Mormonism or evangelical or Catholic or any other expression of Christianity or whatever, they're worldviews. Well, your worldview has as much a right to the table as anybody else's does. And in America, we believe everybody has a right to the table, those with an atheist worldview, those with a non-evangelical. And so my philosophy is we work together for the common good where we can, and we disagree in the areas we disagree on without being disagreeable. You don't have to destroy somebody to disagree with them. You can treat them politely, you can treat them with respect, and you can realize, as David and actually Elder Oaks said, people of goodwill often disagree on fundamental issues. That doesn't mean they're a bad person. It just means you disagree.
Thank you.
Well, we've had an opportunity now to hear from each of our panelists, and we're going to move now to some other questions where we'll pose some other inquiries to our panelists. But just before we get to that, I want to make sure that the audience is aware that while we will continue to have a conversation on stage here for the next, 20 minutes or so, we will reach a point in the program where we will turn the time over to you, and if any of you have questions you would like to ask the panelists, you'll have an opportunity to do so. So keep that in mind as we proceed with the conversation. You'll see that there are microphones here, and at the designated time, you can stand and ask a question. But if I could, let me turn to Elder Oaks and Rabbi Saperstein, both of whom represent faiths that have a relatively small number of adherents in the United States. It's actually a little known fact that there are as many Jews as there are Mormons. That comes as a shock to both the Mormons and the Jews, I think, and maybe to others as well. But here's the question. In your tradition, are believers taught that they should draw upon their faith when making political choices? And if so, how should they do so? And as you think about that, is there any general advice you might give for just people of faith in general, as they participate in politics? So how should people of faith draw upon their convictions when making political choices? Let's start with Elder Oaks and then Rabbi Saperstein.
We teach our members to draw upon their religious beliefs, including personal inspiration in all of their important choices, political and others. And on the second question, we believe that people of faith should insist upon their right to participate in the political process on the same basis as other citizens. But they should refrain from beating others over the head with their personal religious beliefs.
The like the Catholic faithful citizenship position, the Jewish tradition believes that in, as I said, in freedom of choice, and that that is one of the things that is really extraordinary. You know, that ability to be God's partner in shaping a better world is something that is, in the words of the great Orthodox scholar Isidore Tursky, raised us above mere biological existence and gave to our lives meaning and destiny and purpose. So we are always taught to use our conscience in making the world better, including in the political process. But we believe that our tradition has a lot to offer, not because we have a right to foist our religion on anyone else, but we have a right to take the rich ethical tradition and put it out in the free marketplace of ideas, which is how I understand what the bishop's pastoral letters have done. Look first to the lessons from Catholic doctrine, and then in the natural law frame, put it out in rational thought accessible to people like me that don't accept the doctrine because of the power it can have in the free marketplace of ideas. And I think it's something we all share in common here. So what does a good Jew do? They're knowing that their ethical formation and conscience is going to be forged by a number of different factors, their religious tradition, their education. I mean, look at Notre Dame. What an extraordinary institution. A source of pride to American Catholics because of the role it has played in terms of faith and values and education here. Source of pride to Catholics, and frankly, a source of pride to all Americans. It's an extraordinary institution. But there are lots of different influences that shape your ideas and your conscience here. But part of it needs to be, however it speaks to you, your religious tradition with an open mind. You should go and look for the moral lessons of your tradition. Perhaps the answers given by the great scholars in our past feel relevant today. Perhaps the values and ideals that we see as universal help infuse your political discussion there. That's up for you to make that decision. But ultimately, we think good Jews ought to, with an open mind, go to see what the lessons of their tradition are, and then take that with other factors that shape their conscience and put it out there. I do believe, and would pose this to the Archbishop, I agree with you that voters should never be coerced. Here, it was one of the things that I think troubled many people when they saw the idea of cutting off communion to voters, and were very heartened by Pope Benedict and Cardinal Ratzinger's letter saying, no, we don't do that, with a very narrow exception of where someone votes for a candidate supporting an evil primarily or entirely because of that reason. Here, I would just pose the question, if people are entitled to vote their conscience, even as they best think framed by the teachings of the Catholic tradition, isn't there an element of coercion if you have to ask for forgiveness for the way that you voted in the voting booth? I don't think in general religious groups ever ought to ever impose religious authority for authoritarian sects telling their people how to vote, threats, coercion, punishment for something they've done. And I was always a little troubled by that one narrow exception, which I understand as an ethical principle, I really do. But in balancing that against the need for people to go in the voting booth and truly vote their conscience and not feel that they will ever be punished for it, I wonder how that gets reconciled.
Archbishop Kurtz, why don't you go ahead and address that for a moment,
thanks,
if you would.
Thanks, Rabbi David. I think there's a distinction here. And one is, coercion has to do with how we conduct ourselves in public. With regard to our affiliation with a faith community, that is a choice that everyone makes. I mean, I was baptized as a Catholic. I was probably only about this big and maybe about 10 days old. But I had to make a continual choice to be an active member of that faith. And part of that choice is to be a person of integrity. In other words, to say that as a Catholic, I really do desire, always imperfectly, but to embrace and be formed by the moral teachings as well as by the spirit that we've talked about tonight. Now, in doing that, I think what we have found, we may talk about this a little later, is that people may attach a label, well, I'm a Catholic or I'm an evangelical or whatever, but what I have found stronger is, to what extent is that person participating in the life of the church? And their ability to participate remarkably parallels their understanding of, and they're being formed by the teachings themselves. So I guess I would make a distinction between people who might carry a label, I'm Catholic, but those who have actively participated, and I think the research has shown this, it's remarkable how many people don't want to give up their faith. Actually, we have to be careful that one of the roles of a church is both pastorally to reach out to people, but also to preserve the faith. And how do we preserve that faith? Well, by the way in which we live it in our daily lives. So I would say that the coercion has to do with the fact that no one can be forced to vote for a particular person. But remember also that you and I make an active decision to participate in the life of a faith community. You are not forced, nor am I, and thank God for that freedom that we have. And that would be, I think, the line of reasoning that we would go. I just add one other thing, and that is, I think something that's at the very level of what's being talked about tonight is the great effect that faith and religion has had on culture. And so I'd hate to have us not understand the richness that has occurred because of that faith conviction. David.
Kathy, you want to?
Okay, great. The prior question, the one just answered, was really focused on how the voter would bring his or her faith tradition to the ballot box. My question is almost the mirror image question. And what I'd like to ask Pastor Warren and the Archbishop is, to what degree do you think it's appropriate for a voter, a person of faith, to consider the faith of the candidate for office in choosing or in selecting the person for office? And if you think it's appropriate, what aspects of that faith tradition are appropriate? We'll start with you, Pastor.
Well, first, I agree 100% with what Archbishop Kurtz just said. I just wanted to say amen to that. when I go into a voting booth, I'm electing a president, not a pastor. So I want him to have presidential skills, not necessarily pastoral skills. If I go to a doctor and I've got a brain tumor, I don't walk in and say, "Are you an evangelical?" I just want to know, have you ever done this surgery before? and so, in one sense, I have to remember, I'm not voting for a religious position. I want to know, is this person competent to lead? And do they have marks of leadership? On the other hand, I would say to you, never apologize for voting your values, because everybody does that. Liberals vote liberal values, conservatives vote conservative values, gays vote gay values, Christians are okay to vote Christian values, and whatever religion or whatever you're, don't apologize for that, because everybody votes their values. And so people say, well, I don't think your values should have any condition. That's nonsense. Everybody votes their values. And so you're gonna take it into account, but it's not the only thing you take into account.
Well, Kathleen, I just want to say that I agree 100% with what.
This is a love question.
I do agree that we really, when I vote, I don't take into account the religious background of a person. I will say this: I do take into account what flows from their moral seat, let's say. And so I look at things like what I would call public virtue. The capacity of a person to be a person, a man or a woman of integrity, to be someone who is willing to be courageous. And in so doing, I think it gives me some assurance that once elected, that person's not going to just cave in to pressures, but they really are going to act, and I will say the second thing, they're going to act consistently with what they promised. So that the platform I find to be very important. Again, neither of these flow necessarily right from a religious conviction or a sentiment. And of course, the record that somebody has is, I think, especially important as I go forward. So I really do agree that we, I don't think in our Catholic faith or in me personally, we would say, well, the actual religion of that person is the thing that will sway me on voting for or against the person, but rather maybe the, let's say the quality of a character of that person, and that often flows from religious sentiment.
Elder, would you like to step in here?
I'd like to add to that this idea. I want to support a person for public office that has something higher than their own self-interest by which they believe they will be judged. Yeah. I want a person who feels accountable to a higher power. How they define that is far less important to me than the fact that they feel that accountability. And next, I want a person of integrity, and I'm glad to measure integrity by how well a person adheres to their own system of belief, whatever that is.
Well, let me follow up on that. Mm-hmm. Let me ask you this, Archbishop. Paul Ryan has said at various points on record, on television and otherwise, his model is Ayn Rand. And Ayn Rand couldn't be more antithetical by anyone's definition to the gospel message than, I don't know of anyone who could present an alternative so far diverse, come to think of it. But that's what he said. And now he also says, well, he is a Catholic, and that's what's led him to his position on no exceptions on abortion and the like. And so I would ask you, since I have a loaded question here, what gives?
Yeah. Well. First of all, thanks for directing it to me. it makes sense for me to say that we don't coerce voters and we don't endorse candidates. So obviously, while I know your question is sincere, it would lead me in trying to answer that into an area that I've already said I won't go. However, we can sit together here and be friends.
Richard, I wanted to bring you into the conversation, although you seem to be able to do that very well on your own. But let me just shift gears a little bit and ask a slightly different question. You know, it's interesting, when we assemble a group like this, we have people from these different religious traditions which have very different structures. So we have some members here who are part of a hierarchy. There's an organizational chart, and you can find their place on that chart. And then we have others where, you know, the faith tradition is much more decentralized. And so my question is actually about the role of religious leaders here in the United States. What should the role of religious leaders of whatever type be in our debates over public issues? How should they be involved? Should they speak directly to elected officials? Should they try to speak to the public as a whole, that is people who are not necessarily of their own faith? Should they limit their comments and their advice to just members of their tradition? What role should folks like people we have here play in politics?
So if Paul Ryan is a part of the Catholic tradition, should I be speaking to him about what I consider to be his duplicity? Is that the right word? Well, that's just a rhetorical question. Let me say that I'm probably more aggressive about pushing these men and women than would be my colleagues, because I'm not a pastor like Rick Warren, or an elder in the hierarchy of the Mormon Church, or an archbishop, for that matter. I'm closer to David Saperstein, who is an advocate, a lobbyist extraordinaire. And I feel the freedom to say what I think needs to be said. And that's because I don't have an official role. In fact, because I said what I thought needed to be said, they took it away from me. Chuck Colson said Richard was divisive. I wasn't divisive. I was only divisive to him. God bless him. I loved him too. I don't want to politicize the faith. That's what the religious right has done and the religious left has done. But you have to have leaders. And let's face it, most evangelicals, this is really sad news, 18 to 29, Public Religion Research Institute, David and I are both on the board. Robbie Jones just told me the other day, 18 to 29-year-olds, only 30% evangelicals believe that the disparity between the rich and the poor in this country is any concern to them. Only 32% say we ought to hold our country's leaders and businesses to higher environmental standards by regulations. But when you think about that, what they're saying as 18 to 24-year-olds, I guess it is I'm just parroting what I got from my parents. And they've not changed. We know, as the 29-year-olds revealed, they've left the fold, the family fold, and they're willing to be a little more independent. So I don't think there's any, that's my principle about it. It's T-I-N-A principle. There is no alternative. There is no alternative to religious leaders being religious leaders, which is to say, assuming at least a prophetic role now and then to hold these public officials accountable to a higher standard. And that may mean, as I, to be quite candid, said in the last presidential election, I wasn't happy with the temperament of one of the candidates. Why? Because I spent 30 years inside the Beltway and walking the halls of Capitol Hill, and I'd seen too many instances in which the temperament displayed was not, to my thinking, compatible with the Oval Office. So I think it was my duty to say that publicly, which I did in a Huffington Post column. And I didn't say whom to vote for. I generally, we agree, there's a consensus here. But I am telling the constituency, which I do to some degree represent, these new evangelicals, that you have no alternative than to speak up for the values which you really believe are important as God leads you to have them. But as you seek those values in His Word, because evangelicals are biblicists, Biblicism is one of our hallmarks. We're conversionists, evangelists, and we're Christocentrics. And I think that the Jesus message is that these are really important values. Yes, it is important how you communicate and the methodology. How you say it is so vital to what happens afterwards. But there is no alternative to holding these people who are running for public office to standards of truth. Do they tell the truth? Do they have the right temperament? Because if we, on this stage, don't say these things now and then, and hold, then who is? Because we know we have an illiterate public. Gosh, and I wrote down the trends. And they aren't good. And by the way, one of the factors which was going to come up, namely, what about the growing numbers of nuns, those who aren't part of any one of these faith groups? What about them?
Yeah, we should clarify, that's not the...
N-U-N-S.
Not the N-U-N kind of nuns.
But what about...
It's the N-O-N.
We know from a real able scholar, I'll end on this note, who co-wrote a book with Robert Putnam, called American Grace.
Go on.
Yes. That if you put it on a graph, if you put it on a scale where over here is secular and here's religious, and you ask, well, what happens in this, diagram, does the curve go like this? Does it go more religious means less involvement? No. We know that the more religious you are in our society, the more active you are politically, the more you problem solve in your local community, the more often you go to rallies, the more often you care, blah, blah, blah. So you follow me. The curve goes like this. And if you have more nuns, N-O-N-E's, then arguably you're going to have a further decline in people who really do care. And so I'm making an argument for a much more aggressive standard that is needed, in my opinion.
Thank you. And we have much more wisdom and insight here than we do time, which is unfortunate. So I'd like to see if Rabbi and Pastor and Elder would like to, I think you've been left a little bit out of the conversation here. Would you like to add anything to this set of questions, anything that takes it in a direction you'd like to go? And then I think we're moving on to the student questions.
Say two things very quickly. Number one, you will never find any leader that you agree with 100%. So you can pick and choose, say, well, this guy doesn't believe like I do, so therefore, in this area, therefore I'm going to dismiss all the other good things that he's doing. That's nonsense. But my wife doesn't even agree with me 100%. Okay, which, by the way, is another thing. If we're going to have civility in our nation, people have to realize we can. If I disagree with you, it doesn't mean I hate you, and it doesn't mean I'm afraid of you. That's nonsense. You'll never find anybody who agrees with you completely. And just because I disagree with you doesn't mean I hate you. In fact, I can love people I disagree with. One of them is called my wife. The second thing is, it's very important that you be aware, if you're going to fight for civility, be aware of passion projection. I believe that God actually gives us different passions to feel passionate about. Some people feel passionate about the environment, and it's like the most important thing to them. And others will go, yeah, I know that's important, but I really care about sanctity of life. And then other people say, they're really passionate about sanctity of life. Other people say, I'm passionate about sanctity of life. Yeah, I know that's important, but I really care about the poor. And then somebody else says, yeah, I'm really passionate about the poor, but I really care about secure defense. Does this mean that these people are bad because they have different passions? No. And so you can vote your passion. Just don't assume that everybody who doesn't vote your passion is an idiot. They're not.
That's quite a voting guide.
It takes all kinds of people. God wired us to care about different things, so everything in the world would get done. If we all liked to do the same thing, there would be a lot left undone. And so God wired us to feel passionate about different things.
Nothing to add at this point.
I would throw in a couple of other points as well here. On the question of the role of religious leaders, I think religious leaders in political life have the same obligation that every religious person has, to look in their tradition, to draw what their conscience tells them is the right thing to do, and speak truth to power, to speak out and be a moral goad to the conscience of the country in accordance with your conscience and the wisdom that God has given you. And what you've managed to learn in the studies that you're involved with. All of that shapes who you are and what you'll speak out about and according to the passion of your heart. But we all have that obligation. Some leaders speak out with more effect simply by dint of their intelligence, their persuasiveness, their eloquence. They're looked on, you know, for guidance in a way that because they represent extraordinary institutions and they represent the consensus views of the leadership of those institutions, et cetera. So that's what the role is, but I think we're all in agreement. It's not endorsing or opposing. You might be able to do that as an individual here, but not on behalf of the religious institutions of which you are part. And just a word on the question about faith and does faith ever play? Look, I think there are a lot of times that candidates can talk legitimately about faith in an election. We have a right to know what people think about freedom of religion, in freedom of worship, in their views on school prayer and vouchers and the contraception and coverage and hiring discrimination by religious groups with government. We have a right to know what people think about those, and that's fine. People have a right to talk as they help America know who they are about how their personality and values were shaped, the kind of thing you were talking about, by religion. How can you understand Mike Huckabee or Mitt Romney or Joe Lieberman, who spoke on religious freedom here, or any of the myriad of candidates that so many of you can think of without understanding the role that faith played about it? But what it shouldn't ever be, ever, directly or implicitly, is to suggest a religious test for office. Mm-hmm. The Constitution bans the government from doing that. But if I can stand with a good Republican here, Teddy Roosevelt, who in the midst of the anti-Catholic doctrine, speaking to the Knights of Columbus, they said the spirit of that ban on a test for religious office ought to apply to the voting electorate. They should never vote for or against a candidate because of their religious identity, but rather the qualifications for that person for office here. So when we hear people, you know, ads that say vote for them because they're a good Jew in Jewish neighborhoods, or they have good Christian values, or those kinds of things, that really undermines the diversity. How do I compete with someone, if I'm running a race against someone, intention's going to be good Christian values or good Mormon values. How can I compete against that? There should never be a test for this. I think America's greatness, in part, has been precisely because we have inched closer and closer to that day where people, without regard to their religious identity, it used to be people thought Jews couldn't be elected to office, or blacks couldn't be elected to office, Mormons couldn't be elected, Catholics could never be it. You know, we now have become a truly inclusive society. Right. We're not there yet, but we've made enormous strides, in part because we believe there should never be a religious test for office, and America is the better for that.
Thank you.
Well. We, as promised, we are now going to give you the opportunity to ask questions of our panelists here. So if anyone here has a question that you'd like to pose, please feel free to come up to the microphones here in the front. While that's happening, let me caution everyone, we may not get to all the questions, but we'll get to as many as we can. If you have a question, let me remind you what that means. This is the professor coming out in me. A question is brief,
a little bit,
to the point, and ends in a question mark.
It ends in a question mark. That is a question.
We'll start over on this side.
I want to thank you all for coming. My name is Michael Massey, and I'm a junior here at Notre Dame. My question for you all is, in America, it seems that religious diversity has increased immensely. How does this religious diversity, including those with no religious backgrounds, affect our national view of religion's role in politics and government as a whole?
I'll say something.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Michael, I'll say something to begin with. I know each of us will have a sense. The key, I think, is that we are involved without losing the richness. As long as we don't begin to bring things down to the lowest common denominator, meaning you can only say something if everybody agrees. If we get into that situation, we will lose the richness that has made our nation great. But civility, which Pastor Warren has talked about, means that we need to be respectful as we listen to other people, even those who don't agree with us.
Would others like to weigh in?
I would add just this word addressed to the increase of people who don't have any religious belief or feeling. That causes me concern because of the great importance of the free exercise of religion, and by what I hear in public debates on the strength of religious, or the strength of the free exercise privilege in this country. I'm fearful that as the numbers of people who have no religious faith or who are aggressively atheistic increases in our society, this is a threat to the free exercise of religion because they do not value religious expression or participation.
Thank you.
I would say liberty makes diversity more likely. The more religious liberty you have, the more diversity you have in this country. And I would add that diversity makes religious liberty all the more necessary. And the two go hand in hand. I don't think that, I'm not sure I understand completely, Elder Oaks, what you've just said. I resonate completely as an evangelical with that. But I would have to say I'm a little bit uncomfortable by it too, because I happen to think that there is a kind of phobia against not just minority religions, Muslims, Mormons, and others, but there's a certain phobia too directed toward those of no faith. And so I'm just a little sensitive to about how we describe the future for this country. I'm not afraid, frankly, of more diversity. I'm not threatened by it. I actually welcome it.
I'm not afraid.
And that may be a little bit of difference between us here.
I'm not afraid of more diversity, but I believe it imposes upon all of us who have religious beliefs and who rely on the free exercise of religion to make the case for that clearer and more persuasive. We can't take it for granted.
Fair enough.
And I would add, I think, something that you said earlier, Richard, and that is that the research that David and Mr. Putnam have come up with shows that it tends to be people in general who have a deep religion who tend to be the ones most involved. That's not always the case, but that's especially a reason for that. Thank you.
Thank you for that question. Why don't we move over to this microphone here, next up.
All right, my name's Elizabeth, and I'm a doctoral student in theology here. Mm-hmm. And my question actually picks up on what y'all were just talking about. When you look at a lot of the free exercise legal cases coming out of the United States and Europe, a lot of times the cases seem to be framed as a conflict between somebody exercising some aspect of their religion and another value that's really important to our society. And I just wanted to hear what you all thought about, are there religious liberties that should be non-negotiable, and how do we approach trying to find this balance between valuing religious freedom and other values our society may have?
The two lawyers looking at each other. Look, one of the greatnesses of America is its concept of fundamental rights. And one of the most disturbing cases, I think, for all of us was the Oregon v. Smith decision in 1990 that really reduced the constitutional protection of free exercise of religion, claiming that the normal test for protect First Amendment rights, that is, the government can never intrude on your First Amendment rights unless it has a compelling reason to do so. Not any reason, not an important reason, but a reason of the first order here, and goes about pursuing that interest in the way that most limitedly imposes on your freedom of religion or other First Amendment right. The most famous example is, if you're at a movie board, you can't amuse yourself by falsely crying fire in a crowded theater, watching everyone trample each other running to the door. The state interest in the safety of the citizenry allows you to restrict the free speech that's involved here. Well, there are times that people engage in religious practices, human sacrifice, you know, to take one example here, in which the state clearly has interests that limit that. Or in the case of some people who don't use religion, transfusions, or any kind of medical care here, where a child is involved, and the state has the ability to intervene to protect the interests of the child. There are always countervailing interests, but they should be done in very restrictive ways here. I think that we've lost our way a little here, and that some of the excesses, the tough things are, what happens when valid moral principles are in tension with each other? So the court upheld unanimously the concept of the church autonomy doctrine just this year. Right, what an extraordinary thing that was. But what happens when church autonomy runs up against the right of someone not to be discriminated against? Well, I think that in many cases, churches have that right to discriminate on religious basis and who they hire, what kind of services they provide. But what happens when tax dollars are involved here? Does any religious group have a right to take tax dollar money from the government to set up a social service program that by law cannot contain religious worship or proselytization or education? There an input a sign out front, no Catholics or Mormons need apply for a job here with our federal dollars? That's a very tough issue. It pits moral principles against each other. And I say the same was true in that contraception issue. The fundamental rights of women that's constitutionally protected to have access to health care against the right of religious institutions not to be forced to do things that violate their religious conscience. When there are two moral principles, you got to find some way to find a reasonable compromise that works at that, you know, to embody core principles for both that the country as a whole can live with without either side giving up the central ethical tenet of. That's very hard sometimes, but it's precisely the civil discourse that Pastor Warren has so eloquently called for that leads us in a way to do that. And we've done it successfully in the past. I think we can do it again.
I want to say, civility does not mean that you yield your convictions. Civility just means you're nice to the people who disagree with you. Martin Luther King was unbending even to the point of civil disobedience. But he was always civil to Bull Connor and everybody else. Peter, in the book of Acts, when the Sanhedrin says, you can't speak about Jesus anymore, says, we must obey God rather than men. There may be times in your life when you are called to do civil disobedience, but you can do it in a civil way. I'm saying you say, you know, I stand with, as a Protestant, I don't have a problem with contraception, but I stand in 100% solidarity with my Catholic brothers and sisters for them to believe what they want to believe and believe scriptures. Saddleback Church every year does iftar dinner with the Muslims in our community, and we've done all kinds of projects together. If all of a sudden there was a law that said all of the Muslims have to serve alcohol in their restaurants, Muslims don't drink alcohol, I would stand in solidarity with Muslims saying they have a right to not serve alcohol. Why? Because you can get it anywhere else. It's not like it's illegal in the nation. You can get it anywhere, but the problem is not many times these religious cases where there are times where the greater good, I agree with you, David, on that. When if it's going to take a human sacrifice, well, then there's got to be some kind of law there. But many of the times, it is the creeping encroachment of government saying, everybody has to do it our way.
I'd like to add, if I could, building on that, I think we're at our greatest with regard to preserving the public good, in which we are, in a very narrow way, and very reluctantly restrict religious liberty. I think a human sacrifice would be a good example where that would be called for. But in general, to impose upon a religious organization to actually violate their law, there needs to be a clear public good. And I think Pastor Warren made it very clear there that it may be not a question. And I think we also have to be students to understand the fine points of the discussion. So, for example, the issue of religious liberty that I know our Catholic faith has opposed most recently with a federal mandate has to do not with a particular availability, it has to do of a service, but rather it has to do with the requirement of a church to pay for something that they themselves cannot agree to. So I think we have to be very narrow, and we're at our best, I think, the more narrow we are in preserving what we might call the public good. Very important.
You know, I've really struggled with this because I remember back when Bob Jones University lost its tax-exempt status over its non-miscegenation policy. And we at the Association of Evangelicals defended Bob Jones University, and the lawyer in the office, Forrest Montgomery, said, well, Richard, do you think we'll ever get a thank you? I said, are you serious? Of course not. We defended him, and I wonder, though they lost, Bob Jones University lost, because there was a larger, greater public good at stake. And I have to honestly say to the Archbishop and to Rick Warren, I am not persuaded that our religious liberty is so violated by this policy and the public good is so minimal, the right of women to contraception, that there isn't in the protections written by the Obama administration sufficient enough balance to not get into a conniption fit about this. Mm-hmm. Now, I know the bishops are. I know my friends on the right really are, and I respect that. I tell you what troubles me more is the limitation of the definition of what constitutes religious or religion.
Here may be an example where we really are not disagreeable, but we do disagree. And I mean that in all fairness. Because I think we have to be very careful that we don't characterize my effort to be very reasonable, to give a reasoned approach, and ultimately, perhaps, to rely on the law of the land, to rely on, if necessary, the Supreme Court. In order to come up to a judgment, but I begin by the careful analysis on the HHS mandate of very carefully saying, well, now, what is required in order to maintain the public good? And obviously, I can tell you that it is restricting our ability. It may not restrict your particular beliefs.
I respect the fact that you feel it is.
Yeah.
So this weighs on my conscience, I have to
tell you.
I'm not saying that I fundamentally disagree with you here. I've kept my mouth shut, frankly, about this. Because out of respect for my Catholic brethren.
Richard, you do realize this is being taped.
Yes.
Well, I don't see any contradiction with what I just earlier said. I said I'm troubled by this. I'm trying to balance it. I have not come out in opposition to what the bishops have said. I'm simply saying it's a really tough call for me, I honestly confess. That's all I'm saying. But out of respect for the bishops, I've not publicly taken an antithetical position of what you're saying.
Well, we're really looking not just at the bishops, but of people of goodwill, looking at to what extent is this really wise to restrict religious freedom? Yeah. Is the issue of such a level that it really justifies a restriction? I would say no.
Well, people of goodwill. I think we are all here trying to be people of goodwill and people of sincere and honest faith in trying to grapple with our responsibilities coming up with at the ballot box, but more generally as citizens. And while we don't have time to explore all of the fascinating and detailed and controverted and painful questions that have been raised today at length, I think we've made a good start. So, two things. First, I would like to say that unfortunately not all of our panelists will be able to stay and talk a little bit more later on, but a few of them will, and after we leave and kind of wander out, maybe in the lobby, should you like to speak to a few of the panelists a little bit more, I see a long line of questions, some of the panelists will be available. But most importantly, I'd like to ask you to stand with me in thanking our panelists and my co-moderator, Professor Campbell, for a wonderful panel.
Why don't we head out and then you can, those who are available can wander up.